Welcome to the Nomadic Delights podcast. Join me, your nomad consultant, for this episode as I sit down with Abdi for the lockdown challenge part 2. In preparation for the second wave that will soon hit the UK, Abdi shares with me a selection of what to watch. Let me know if you agree with the movie guru, and if not, give me a shout out. If you enjoyed today's show, spread the love by sharing it with your friends. Finally, make sure you never miss an episode by subscribing to our show on Apple, Spotify, YouTube. And please, leave me a review. Peace and love. Okay, guys, I'm joined by today Abdi, and we're going to talk on a very interesting subject, and it's going to be called, actually, movies to watch in the second wave. Actually, Abdi came up with that name, really good name, Abdi. Tell me more about this today's show, man.
There's a couple of things. I mean, I'll be honest. I don't know about anyone else who listened to it. I haven't even listened to the last one that we did, but I felt it was poor, man.
That was definitely on me.
I did no research. I know you were pestering. Do your research? Like, yeah, no worries, man. I'll wing. But it was Ramadan as well.
Yeah.
And nobody wants to do extra work on Ramadan. I don't even do the work I get paid for during Ramadan. Yeah. So I was like, then I try to wing it. It'll be fine. But we were chatting gibberish, like hardcore gibberish. I mean, talking about Dolph Lundgren and Masters of the Universe. That was a secret I thought I'd be taking to the grave with me, you know? Everyone knows how I like Masters of the Universe. He and Masters of the Universe. So I just thought, let's go at this again, you know? And let's do it properly this time, yeah?
Okay.
And so, I know MJ. It's a shame MJ can't join.
Because he's well versed
in movies and things like that as well, so it's a but I'll try and I just felt I owed something better.
I honestly don't know what you're saying. I really enjoyed that last session. I also thought you actually gave yourself a good account of yourself, but hey, since you're driving this, go for it, bro.
That's all I thought. Action films. that's it. One dimensional. I gave one dimensional account of the things that I watch. But yeah, I just thought, let's, as we're slowly coming out of the lockdown, whether that's right or wrong.
a different day, mate.
Side. And inevitably, I think there will be a second wave. So I just thought, let's do something that films to watch before the second wave. Yeah,
okay.
it can be like one or two films because you're a pessimistic kind of guy or
right.
You know, you just think second wave literally around the corner, or someone like me, I'm optimistic.
But I like to pretend
to be optimistic. I'm optimistic, so I've chosen a raft of films.
Okay.
I lost count. I lost count after 15. Yeah, there's quite a few that I'm going to be mentioning here, focusing on some though.
Yes.
Because of topical, what's been happening lately in the US and George Floyd and all the protests and the riots and the nonsense that you're getting from politicians over there and the police.
Yeah.
So I just thought let's make it topical. Let's look at Black Lives Matter kind of movies and shows that I think still, funny enough, some of them are old, but they still resonate today, which is a sad thing to say.
Yep.
The same stuff that was happening 30 odd years ago is happening today. You know, so let's kick off with that.
Yep.
So I've jotted down a few films.
Okay.
Some you can find on Netflix. Some elsewhere. But let's do one of the classics. My man Spike Lee in one of his early films, going way back to 1989, and that's I'm sure a lot of people have seen it. Do the Right Thing. It's one of those films. It's set in a Brooklyn neighborhood,
okay.
Which is predominantly occupied by blacks and Latinos.
Okay.
And the film is on, like on a very hot day in New York, and you know when New York gets hot, New York gets hot. So simmering tensions throughout. Yeah. So it's just looking at the daily lives of the people who live there and what they get up to and how they interact. Yeah. But the focal point of the film is really around a pizzeria restaurant that's there. It's owned and run by an Italian guy and his two sons who don't live in the neighborhood. But rely on the residents for their livelihoods, which is it's just how it goes sometimes, isn't it? Where they need the black man's money,
yeah.
But do not at the same time respect what they do and what they stand for. Now the owner of the restaurant he's been there 25 years, built a fantastic restaurant. His one of his sons is an absolute, I can't say it because this is a family bust, but he's got some serious issues. Uses the N-word for fun, trying to get his dad to get out. But you know, his dad's like, look, there's nothing else for us. We can't go to our neighborhood because there's pizzeria galore. So you can see what his motivation is there, that he just, you know, he knows he's making money here, so he'll continue as is. But throughout the whole film there's simmering racial tensions, and you get the obvious negative police presence,
yeah.
You know, and which results in overflow of emotion with a tragic end. Radio Rahim, You watch that film and all you'll think about is Radio Rahim. It's quite painful at the end, and you can see what happened then is still happening today. And how the police react if you're somebody of color, and how they treat you, they still go for the negatives straight away. It's definitely. I don't want to ruin it for anyone, but yeah. It's definitely worth a watch. You're not going to find it on Netflix, unfortunately. Okay, if you do have, they do have it on there. So, but find it wherever you can. I mean, nowadays you don't need any kind of subscription to watch anything. So yeah, find it. Definitely one of those films. I would, if you haven't seen it, highly recommend it. And that's the first one that. First one on my list.
So Spike Lee, Do the Right Thing. Okay, I'll be honest, I haven't watched it, so I'm actually going to keep an eye out for that.
Shame, man, for shame.
Yeah, for real, bro. No, like I said, it is now on my to-do list. I'll be honest, I tell myself the world is a tough place as it is. I don't need to be reminded, but I think sometimes for some people this is important just to see how life is. But yeah, go ahead. So that's the first choice.
You have to. It's always around you. You can't bury your head, and it's important to see how others portray it and the troubles they go through. Okay, so the next one I went for is called Fruitvale Station.
Okay, Fruitvale Station. I haven't heard this one.
Fruitvale Station. It's based on true life events. There's a guy, a black guy, Oscar Grant. So this film is really based on his final few hours on New Year's 2009. It stars Michael B. Jordan, our man in Creed.
Yep, legend.
And it's, I think it's one of the films that really set him on his way. It's a great performance by him. So just to give you what the film's about, I'll keep this one short and sweet. So you know, it's New Year's Eve, there's a lot of people around, guys on a train get into a bit of a scruff with some others. Police are called, these guys are detained at this station, train station, by the police, and it just boils over. Police use excessive force, and during the struggle, Oscar Grant's life is taken. It's definitely worth a watch, and it's one of those films that gets you angry. And during the time, how he died was just astonishing. And there is real life footage of the incident as well. Simply because there was just so many people there. The train was still on the platform, I think. And there's a lot of people with their cameras recording what happened. So it's one of those films that's, you know, is 11 years ago, and it's still happening today. Nothing much has changed. I don't think it will. I highly recommend people to watch this one, definitely.
Okay. Look, I'll be honest. I
just think I've gone for the grim choices. I think it's definitely it's worthwhile. It's worthwhile knowing what's happening out there, and when you get incidents like George Floyd, it triggered me to start looking around for, you know what, let me start watching some of these again. Let me see what else is out there. And the sad thing is, there's so many to choose from. I had probably a list of 10 just on this section alone. I could have spoken about, and it's sad. It's the state of the world that we live in, that there's plenty of choice around this arena where there's excessive force or brutality by police against ethnic minorities. It's shocking, but yeah, that's
it's even though I don't like watching it, but I think it's good these movies are out there, because if we get used to it, then it becomes a norm. So it's good these movies, they talk about it, so people can actually realize, you know what, we shouldn't accept this as a standard. It shouldn't be the norm. But yeah, and it's a necessary kind of feature of our life. We have to watch things so we don't repeat our mistakes again. But it seems like for the US, they haven't learned. It just keeps on going on and on until someone gets actually, you know, punished properly. It will keep on going on.
And these kind of movies kind of get you to maybe look into the real life events. So you're aware of it. Hopefully people will learn. But it's very difficult in the US, and there are definitely reasons behind that. That we can go into, but for weeks trying to discuss. So my next choice is another Netflix. So Netflix are smashing it, really. It's called American Son. Stars Kerry Washington. And it's really about a mother just trying to get help from the police in finding her son. She hasn't heard from him. She thinks that something's happened. It's set in a police waiting room, and she's just getting blocked from this police officer, this white police officer, who is asking her the stupidest questions. You know, she's saying, listen, help me find my son. You know, he might be hurt, he might be in trouble, all of this stuff. And he's just asking, okay, is he in a gang? Does he have drugs issues? You know, does he have any warrants? Things like that. And which kind of, puts her back against the wall, and she's thinking, what the hell are you asking me? That's not what's happening. You ask this of white parents who are asking the same thing.
Correct.
So there is visually, there's not much to see. You're not going to see a lot of different scenes.
Yeah.
But it's so emotionally charged, and she gives an amazing performance in it. It's now becoming, it's become one of my top films to watch, just simply because of her performance.
Right. And the fact, like you said, it's all kind of shot at the police station. So it's like you said,
you're only going to see a few. There's only a few characters. I won't ruin too much, but her husband, and the police and two police officers are involved. So you don't see a lot of characters in it, but it's very emotional. It does get you annoyed and angry at some time, which I think, you know, and I think that's the natural reaction that you should get. If you don't get angry about stuff like this and the questions being asked, then then you really have to have a look, good hard look at yourself, you know.
It's actually, and that's another third movie I haven't seen, especially talking about the whole race. So I'm actually, you know, jotting these names down as we go through. Okay. What's the next one? And is it still within the...
This is a classic, this one.
Okay, go ahead.
Not on Netflix. Don't think it's on Sky.
Yeah.
People haven't seen this. They really need to watch it. It's called 12 Angry Men. Most definitely one of my favorite films.
Okay.
It's a classic film. It's got Henry Fonda in it.
Before you continue, is this staying with the topic of Black Lives or?
Absolutely.
Seriously?
Yes, it does. Yeah.
No, it does. My gosh. What's it called? What's it called? 12?
12 Angry Men.
Okay. All right.
So it's set on a trial of a young guy, okay. Hispanic, I think it was. Accused of killing his father. So the film starts with a trial happening, and the trial finishes, and then the jury, who are made of all of them are 12 white men. I think it's set in the 50s or 60s. So 12 white men go back into their room to deliberate the case, with all automatically believing the young kid is guilty, and all because of bigotry is what in that decision. They automatically shut all the evidence out of their minds and say, "No, he's done it. That's what they do. That's what these people do." So Henry Fonda's character is so cool, calm, and collected, puts race aside, and gets them to focus on the facts of the case. Right. I don't want to ruin stuff, but it's a really, really, really fantastic watch, and it's just in this one room most of the time, and you just see how people's minds are actually opened up when they look at things differently, and they put the color of someone's skin to one side and just look at facts. Brilliant. It's a brilliant one to watch.
Wow. Okay, that's another on my to do, and I do like movies with cold cases because it's kind of gives you hope, you know. But yes, okay, perfect.
My final one in this category, is not a movie. It is on Netflix. Okay. It's a documentary. It's called 13th. So okay. it's a brilliant documentary. It's a really, really good documentary, and it analyzes the criminalization of African Americans. Following the U.S. Civil War, so the 13th is actually the 13th Amendment of the U.S. Constitution, which abolished slavery in the U.S. after the Civil War, and it made former slaves free. But the amendment, as these things always do, the amendment had a bit of a loophole in it.
Okay.
So it said the benefits of that clause did not apply to criminals who would continue to lose their rights continue to do a life of servitude and labor. So when the Civil War happened and slavery was abolished, that really hurt the U.S. economy. It was going to have a massive impact on the U.S. economy because they've lost all that free labor, effectively. I'm a skeptical guy, I guess. So you just think, okay, well, they threw this loophole in, or this loophole used in such a vicious, vicious way that it imprisoned a lot of black men en masse for the smallest little things, smallest little crimes, because they needed that economy to continue, and they needed that workforce. So it's a really, really good documentary, and it shows you how African Americans, black men in particular, were made to be evil, be portrayed to be evil.
Oh my gosh.
Criminals, rapists, all of that stuff. And how that went into the American psyche for decades to come. And then it goes on to look at what happened in the 70s with Nixon, yeah. and his agenda of a war on crime, again just saying, well, look, crime is happening, all of this stuff, da da da. Again, using different words, but you know, kind of focusing on one particular group, always African American, and always the men. Then he kind of just looks at what Reagan did in the 80s and his war on drugs, where you had two drugs, yeah, prevalent during the 80s. You had cocaine, mm-hmm, and you had crack cocaine.
Yeah.
So two different communities completely using them. Where cocaine, you probably just get a slap on the wrist because it's looked at as, it's okay, sophisticated. Mm-hmm. It's going to be used by yuppies and all of that nonsense, right? Where crack cocaine was, you know what, this is evil. And, you know, they went at them hard. Mm-hmm. They got them and they put them in prison. And then it kind of goes into what happened in the 90s as well. And sad to say, Democrat Bill Clinton's decision to introduce a third strike rule. So if you, if you were put in prison, if you were convicted three times or whatever the three strike rule is, you're in prison for a ridiculously long amount of time. So that kind of just got, that filled the prisons ridiculously. So how these decisions and how it was disproportionate with who went into prison as well. Mm-hmm. And then how the prison system kind of became a business. Mm-hmm. It's part of the economy over there, where prisons are being built, where the catering of those prisons and how they need people in there to make it work.
Yep.
You know, so it's one of those documentaries that
another form of slavery, basically. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah,
that's exactly what it is. That's exactly what it is. It's a painful documentary to watch, and it kind of shows you why we're in this situation today. Mm-hmm. How we got to this situation where a police officer will just stop a black guy just for walking down the street in the US. That happens, and to be honest, that happens here as well. It's one of those ones. If you're not going to watch any of the rest I've recommended, yeah, watch that one. Just definitely watch that one. If you don't watch any of the stuff I recommended, you're an idiot, and I don't like it.
Yeah. No. I don't mean
to tell you, but no, definitely, it's probably out of all of those ones, I would watch 13th. It does enlighten you with how we got to where we are.
Yes.
You know, it's brilliant. And the documentary starts off with just a simple bit of data where it just says the UK accounts for 5% of the world's population, but 25% of incarcerations.
The US, you mean? Yeah, the US.
The US.
Yeah.
That's an astonishing figure. So that kind of just gives you an insight of where the documentary is going, and it just it's a brilliant watch.
That's good, because I do like, even though it's depressing, it's informative, and if you know, knowledge is power, I always believe. So I think that's a good one. Then the question I had, I thought you were going to say for your last one on this topic of Black Lives Matter, I thought you're going to mention the whole America History X. You ever seen that one with Edward Norton? That was my first time I actually came across him as an actor.
And for me, I
was amazed, yeah, with that movie, simply because it showed me the perspective of the racist side of it, you know, the whole skinheads and especially where, I mean, they can rebadge themselves, call themselves the alt-right or whatever, but they still have that same philosophy of, you know, blacks and whites should mix. And but what kind that's, of an, yeah,
that's what I'm saying. There's so many sad state of affairs that there's so many to choose from. And you know, I kind of try to go for ones that people maybe haven't seen.
Yes, yeah.
The American choice. History is a classic.
Yeah, yeah.
And he's amazing in it. And there's always one scene that I remember.
Oh, no. Don't.
And you know which scene, automatically you know which one I'm talking about.
I'm talking about the beginning, okay?
The curve.
Yes, the curve. That's all I'm going to say. Yeah. Finish.
And then I was, I don't think I slept after seeing that. That just stuck in my mind. But yeah.
It's crazy and I think, but no, honestly, I am Abdi, all of those movies and documentary are especially in this time and this climate, especially for people who are not black, I strongly recommend to understand and to look at it in today's context. I think it's relevant. I hope we do see a change, but I mean, for the US, this will be a true test for them as a country. And as well as a,
I don't think it is. There was obviously you had the 92 riots. Is it 92, 93? The LA riots, Rodney King.
Yeah.
There's been so many other things that have happened since then, and in fact that have happened quite recently. I mean, there was that, I forget the guy, Aubrey. The two guys in the US. This George Floyd one had a similar one to one about 6 years ago, and embarrassingly I've forgotten the guy's name who lost his life there, but he was being choked by a police officer and repeatedly saying I can't breathe. It seems like this is always going to happen. And when you've got a president who seems weak on the matter, you've got a system that's weak on the matter.
No, thing for me that's what's impressive is that, I mean, hate him or love him, Trump, at least he speaks what he's on his mind. I mean, for Obama, yes, the first black president and everything, but don't forget it was riots under him as well. But the guy had a suave way about it, but no, we're not gonna talk about Trump or Obama. I was tempted.
You need that cooling kind of persona and person just to make everyone chill and to not let things boil over. But sadly, when as it stands right now, that's not the effect that we're getting, and it's which probably explains why the protests got to where they did.
Oh yeah.
And the police, which I found shocking, is like, okay, these are protests about brutality, but yet the police are treating the protesters in quite a brutal way. Clearly they hadn't learned anything, so
no,
I won't be surprised if we have similar things again in the future.
Here's a funny thing. Someone said on Twitter recently and made me laugh. They go, I knew Trump would start a war before the election, but I never thought he would start it against his own people. And like you said, you just summed it up. The police who are meant to be actually giving themselves a good account of themselves actually are showing the reason why people are being, you know, are hating them. But okay, perfect. We'll,
I suppose nobody's talking about coronavirus.
No. See, that's okay. Okay.
Okay.
Let's get back to movies. Okay. Juicy, that topic, but no. Okay. So
that is.
Those are the movies you recommend for the second wave, and that's with the context of Black Lives Matter.
Exactly. But obviously, if you guys still want to watch He-Man Masters of the Universe with Dolph Lundgren, please do. it's definitely worth it. It's got Courtney Cox in it as well.
Okay. So what's
But there are a few other things to watch as well.
So. Okay, and what's the context of these other movies you've chosen now? So,
just random ones, to be honest.
Are there any comedies? Because I need some cheering up. I ain't gonna lie to you.
There's a few. I think I had to throw in a couple of comedies in there since I went all serious with the first bit.
Oh yeah, for real.
People are probably depressed now, just thinking, why the hell am I listening to this? So, let me kick off. Do you remember Kung Fu Hustle?
Oh my gosh, of course, man. Classic choice. Good choice. Yes.
No, hold on. That's not my choice, though. Not my choice. Kung Fu Hustle was brilliant, right? Mm-hmm. But the same group did something before Kung Fu Hustle. It's called Shaolin Soccer.
Oh,
I think you may have seen this one.
Yes. So I forgot about that, man. No, yeah. Go ahead.
So it's just a bunch of guys who were taught in a particular kung fu style by this particular master, yeah. And they wanted to bring kung fu to the world, but didn't know how to. So they all kind of ended up in dead end jobs, just trying to graft somehow, some way.
Yeah.
And then they find, oh, you know what? Football is the way to do this. So they bring their Shaolin skills.
Yeah.
Into the game of football. Now it's I'll say it's just a stupid film.
Yeah.
but if you like football, if you like kung fu, and if you like to laugh, it's definitely worth watching. You just think, oh my god, that bit just looks so stupid. But it's a great film. It's a great film to watch, and to watch, just, you know, get your mind off all the seriousness of the world. And
yes,
and the series of films that I selected, the way you should do it is,
yeah,
watch one of the serious ones I've selected, then watch one of these ones I'm about to talk about. Yeah. give you a nice balance. But you remember that one, right?
Oh yeah, bro, it's a classic, man. Because I, when you mentioned Kung Fu Hustle, and I remember how good it was, and then when you mentioned Shaolin Soccer, I go, yeah, because that, but I find it, I watched it after Kung Fu Hustle, because I watched Game of Cross Kung Fu Hustle first. And then I watched Shaolin, and I could see the camera had gone a bit better, you know, the skills. But yeah, it was I do love football, even though they named the soccer. But hey, it's okay. They had to appease the American market, you know?
Yeah, to appease the American market. That's it, man. That's it. another one I went for.
Yeah.
It's Christian Bale. It's a Christian Bale film.
Yeah.
It's called Equilibrium.
Wait.
I won't go too much into it, but it's a cross between 1984,
uh-huh,
and dystopian society,
mm,
and Matrix. it's a great mix. it's some fantastic action films in it, and it's got the 1984 feel to it as well. It's really good.
Mm.
I haven't seen that one for a while, and I'm trying to find it so I can watch it again.
Okay.
Great choice. All my choices are great choices. I'll throw that in there. this is one of the greater choices.
Equilibrium, I know, because he acted alongside the guy who was in what he was in the TV show, wasn't he? I forget, as a lawyer. I mean, it's embarrassing. Okay, you know what I'm talking about? The black guy, wasn't he?
The Tay something or other, right?
I think so. But Equilibrium. I've seen it, and I do like, because I know you like your sci-fi related movies. But 1984 field, I bet you anything. As soon as, who's it?
Tay Diggs.
That's the guy. That's the guy.
Sean Bean as well.
Who?
Sean Bean.
Ah.
GOT.
Ah, yes. okay. Check it out.
I'll help you get it.
Huh? What was that?
I knew that would help you understand it.
Yo, for real. No, okay, so then check it out. Before you continue, is there any other more? Because one funny one just hit in my head. So do you have a few more comedies to recommend? Because I was going to say for Equilibrium.
A few comedies to recommend, yeah.
Okay, sweet. Okay, I'll let you keep on driving. So go ahead, yeah.
Conversation, go.
No, check it out, because in case you move to a different genre, one comedy that I do like, and a lot of people are not, you know, a big fan of him. He had some different, but one of my favorite one, and especially he's made light of a comedy of one of the most serious issues we have today with the whole Israel and Palestine situation, and it's the movie's called You Don't Mess With The Zohan. Have you ever seen that movie?
No, I haven't. That's like one of the only Adam Sandler films I haven't seen.
I ain't gonna lie to you. I think he killed it in that one. And for me, the fact is, I watched it with an open mind, didn't know anything about it, and I just laughed my way through it, despite the fact that it's, you know, talking about a serious issue. But yes, and I hats off, he dealt with a sensitive issue.
Where is it? Is it up there with Little Nicky and Gilmore?
Okay, see, okay, here's the funny thing. You see, and again, this is my only personal opinion, when it comes to how would you say, little Nicky, he acts good, but he doesn't get to really show his skills. But for the Zohan, my man, he actually physically built himself up. It's the same way with Bale did for Batman, yeah, and everything, yeah. This guy really, yeah, he pumped up for the role. For Gilmore, it's a tough one. Yeah, it's a... But look, you say that, but what's that American one that he did with a football player? American...
Yard.
Huh?
The Longest Yard, I think it was called.
No, there was another one where he was a... it's embarrassing, mate.
The one he went into prison.
No, that's a good one. Yeah, okay, you know what? We have to move on to Adam Sandler, because I mean, at this rate, it's going to be the whole Adam Sandler show at this rate. Yeah, okay. But no, for me, unfortunately, the one I wouldn't mind watching again would be the Zohan again. So I think, yeah, for me, it's been my favorite one. What about you?
Little Nicky. Yeah. I like Little Nicky. I like Waterboy.
That's the one. I apologize. Yeah. I'd forgotten. The Waterboy.
That's a really good one.
Yeah.
Mr. Deeds. They're just stupid films. Adam Sandler films. It's just funny. Yeah. It's just, you know, it'll make you laugh and make you love life a little bit. You know, and that's what he's going for. And it works.
It's, you know, I think one thing that I do respect an actor is that not only have they gone from acting in a movie, but now the next big thing, which I wouldn't mind doing, is the whole voiceovers. So like with Eddie Murphy, when he did it with Shrek, Adam Sandler did it with Hotel Transylvania. What they've done is they've actually said, you know, use my image for the cartoon so everyone knows it's them, but also they have their voice, so you kind of, you know, relate to it. The brand is still there, so... I respect actors who are able to transition into that.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's me now. Let's put the mic back to you. Yeah, go ahead.
Well, this, I don't know if anyone's seen this, but I just found that it is on Netflix.
Okay.
And I've put it on my list to watch again, simply because it takes me back to a happier time where, you know, I just laughed and laughed and have a care in the world and it was all about comedy and funny films for me. Yeah. Friday.
Oh. Legend.
That's on Netflix. I'm not really going to talk about Friday much. Oh. I think everybody's seen Friday. Don't watch next Friday or the Friday after next.
Yeah, I agree with you.
Watch Friday. Chris Tucker. Absolutely. He's a legend, Chris Tucker. And I think in most of the films that he's in, he does... He's a Michael Jackson fan.
Yes.
And in most of the films that he always does a Michael Jackson dance or impression.
Correct. Right. But I can't believe you're big enough Chris Tucker over Ice Cube, mate. Ice Cube is my man. I mean, as a kid, that was out of all the West Side rappers. So that's why for me, it's... And you know what's also good? I don't know about Chris Tucker on Twitter, but with the whole Black Lives Movement, Ice Cube has been non-stop tweeting on Twitter, mate. So for me, the reason what made Friday the legend what it is was Ice Cube. That's for me. I know Chris Tucker, I love him as an actor, but Ice Cube, my man.
What's the one line that you remember from that? You know the one line I remember?
I know you don't speak. But I'm gonna make you that one?
No, for me it's like, you just got nuts the f out. Yeah. That's that line that I remember. And it's just the way he delivered it.
Yeah.
Chris Tucker. It's just funny. But it's one of those feel good films. It'll just make you laugh. It'll just make you laugh.
I'll keep
that in there as well. I forget the guy's name, but he's fantastic.
Oh, Ice Cube Dad?
Yeah.
Unfortunately, he passed away. I saw that, and was it a year ago? Or was it, yeah? It shocked me because everyone loves him, because ain't nobody go in that toilet. I mean, the trick with this whole lighter and putting the matchstick, I've learned that from him, man.
Yeah. As I see, my favorite. Makes him stand in there while he's doing his business.
Abdi, that's a beautiful choice, man. That put a smile back on my face, I ain't gonna lie.
It doesn't. I had to search for these things, right? Because I wanted to find out what's on Netflix so people can watch. It didn't give me any notices that this film was on there. That's how Netflix goes. It kind of just throws what it wants at you in their algorithms. Apparently, this is something because you watch this, you want to watch this. It's like, well, no, I'd rather watch Friday. Why need Friday? So
it's funny you say that, because one of the reasons why I love about Friday was, of course, Ice Cube, my main actor. But who is the girl he fights for? I've had a heavy crush on her for years as a kid growing up, mate. You know, Nia Long.
Yeah.
Everyone knows her for Fresh Prince, but I don't think, and of course, with, you know, Boys in the Hood.
She's in Boys in the Hood as well, isn't she?
Oh, no. Mate, don't get me started on... And but anyway, like we said, family friendly podcast and all that. Yeah, but yes, heavy crush on Netflix back in the days. Yeah.
Another one that's on Netflix, which is a classic. Coming to America, Eddie Murphy, Coming to America.
Abdi, you know what? You've chosen some good comedy, positive black movies, mate.
You can see my hair right now. I could do with a bit of Soul Glow.
Well, after you made me laugh, man, that's a good one. Well, after the whole, oh, that's a good one, bro. That's a good one. Well,
and if you don't laugh at that one, then there's something wrong with you. It's some brilliant stuff. A little bit of one that's kind of out there, and I don't know if a lot of people have seen. It's a bit of a cult classic. It's Office Space. I don't know if you've ever seen.
I haven't seen it, but one quick thing before you go to Office Space, is it true? I heard rumors that they're thinking of doing Coming to America part 2 or something.
I heard, somehow,
because when you mentioned it and everyone was thinking, oh, you know what, because they saw the whole success of Wakanda and everything, Black Panther, but at the same time they said, oh, well, why don't they just do a part? That was the rumors I hear, but I don't know. Sometime on Twitter, this is where my main source of information, it could be just a fake rumor and all that. But go ahead, Walala, sorry, about Office Space. I would
risk COVID-19 to go to the cinema to watch that. I'll be the first in that queue, man, in that cinema watching that one.
Look, you say that, but seeing the queues just for basic things like IKEA and Asda, I don't think I'm going to be cinema for a few more months, mate. I'll stick to Netflix, and I'll listen to your recommendations, mate. I ain't gonna lie to you, but you know, even watching online somewhere, legitly, I repeat, you know, I underline that word, legitly.
Well, do what you have to.
Yeah.
Do what you have to. We're all stuck in this lockdown.
So Office Space, is that on Netflix then?
No, it's not. Which is, I'm not sure where anybody will find it, but it's a bit of a cult classic. Just about a group of friends who, and I think a lot of people would relate to it, because it's just the nonsense that you get in an office environment. Problems with equipment, somebody's birthday, birthday cake, how management treat you. So it's all about, and then you've got this guy who experiences all that nonsense. Goes to a hypnotist, and the hypnotist manager says that, you're not going to care about stuff like this. So the hypnotist, he does what he needs to do, but then has a heart attack and dies. So he doesn't actually get this guy out of the state of mind he's been. So it just kind of just goes through how his attitude has changed, and he just doesn't give a damn. But then management see him in a different light and be like, wow, this guy's amazing. He's a take control kind of guy. So it's just a funny watch, and you never know, it might give people the impotence to maybe, you know what, that's how I'm going going to work when we actually do ever get to work. I'll act like this guy and see whether he gets me a promotion.
mate. I think it's kind of good. We can make banter in the world of office, because sometimes it's such cutthroat people living in there that you actually need. But it's true. And movies that makes fun of your office space, people will tend to relate to it more. Okay, I'll put that on my list. And office space.
Also, you need to put all of these on the list. Don't just be picking and choosing ones that sound all right. You need every single one. Like I said, watch one of the tough ones.
Yeah. Okay.
And then
watch one of these. I have to look for the tough one. I ain't gonna lie to you. Just watching the news, it just depresses me. So to watch it in a movie where it's all choreographed and everything, I think I'll stick with the comedy ones for sure. And I might rewatch the Friday one. That's some good old days, honestly.
Yeah, that was probably the better way to go about it, actually.
Mm.
Bill Murray.
Oh, yes.
You like Bill Murray. Groundhog Day.
Oh my gosh, classic. You are
Stripes. He's classic. Always makes you laugh. There was one film I watched years ago. Yeah. It's called What About Bob?
Okay.
So he plays a guy who's got OCD, and he keeps on being passed from therapist to therapist because none of them want to deal with him. So he finds this one who was unlucky enough to get him. He's like, okay, listen, but it's Labor weekend, whatever the US celebrates. Yeah. I'm going away. I'll see him when I get back.
Mm-hmm.
But Bill Murray's character finds out where this guy is and where he's going. Turns up at his home. His second home, and then it's just hilarious how things kind of just unfold, where the family accept him and take him in, but the guy, the therapist, absolutely hates him, and ends up nearly going crazy himself with all the nonsense that Bill Murray and his character get up to. It's like those Mr. Bean. It's like a Mr. Bean type film. it's funny. It's funny to watch. It's highly recommend it.
Well, it's funny because
everything else I've said.
No. And with Bill Murray, for me, it's always been Ghostbusters. I've always known him,
and Groundhog.
Yeah, true. Groundhog and Ghostbusters. But then after that, I watched one movie. I think it was him. Was he in somewhere in Japan or something called Lost in Translation?
Lost in Translation.
Oh
yeah.
My gosh, I fell asleep, mate. I wasn't impressed with that movie.
That's a difficult watch.
Gosh, the worst part for me when I watch movies.
So I don't know why I fell asleep. It's got Scarlett Johansson in it, so I'm not sure why you're asleep. I understand.
I need it to be but saying that though, I'll check it out. So it's called What About Bob? Yeah, I mean, for him,
so yeah, I was just going for one of those films that people, I'm trying to as much as I can go for ones that people haven't seen. There's always going to be those classic ones that I just can't ignore. I know everyone's seen, but it's out there.
Hmm.
And it's worth watching again. But yeah, what about Bob? Not a lot of people have seen it.
True.
And it's a shame because it's a good watch. Mm. Definitely a good watch. So another one that a lot of people have seen.
Yeah.
Pretty sure you've seen. I hope you've seen. Planes, Trains and Automobiles. With Steve Martin and John Candy.
Okay. John Candy, he's passed away, hasn't he?
Yeah, a while back. Yeah. So what this film's about is Steve Martin's character needs to get home for Thanksgiving.
Yes, I recall that.
You remember this one? So you have all the issues with the trains and all that. Plane or whatever it is. And then he kind of teams up with this guy, John Candy, and it's just a hilarious trip to try and get back. And it's taking them like days to get back. And in between, cars are blowing up. They're fighting with with car rental companies and all of that stuff, it's quite funny. if you haven't seen it, if people haven't seen it, definitely go watch it.
That's a good choice, and especially the fact that then I like those two actors. John Candy, of course, enough respect to him, but Steve Martin, I've been impressed with him for quite a while, honestly. Alright, okay, sweet. So that's some really good choice, especially the plane trains. What else you got for us, Abdi?
I've got a few more comedy ones.
Sweet.
And then I'm gonna end with one that it's not a comedy, but I love the film. It's I think it's another cult classic for me. I'll kick off with the comedy ones. House Party. It's got someone from 92, 93, maybe even before that. It's got Kid and Play.
Kid,
a young Martin Lawrence as well. So the premise behind this is, you know, as the title says, a house party. Parents are away. One of the guys wants to get to his party. He can't because he got trouble at school. So he escapes. His dad's hunting for him, and it's just the nonsense that happens between, him sneaking out and getting to the party, and the rubbish that happens after that as well. So and there's some bullies trying to chase him. I don't want to go too much into it because I just think it's one of those films that just needs to be watched, and it's got some of the best dance moves ever.
Of course, Kid and Play, man. I'm not surprised. You know, I haven't. You know what's so funny? Even though I know about Kid and Play, I've never watched that movie. I mean, bear in mind, I was in Egypt at that time.
They did House Party 2, and then there's another one, House Party 3, Pajama Party, or whatever it was. I wouldn't recommend those. Just go for the first.
Yeah. All right, okay. I'll check out the House Party. But you know what's speaking about House Party? I'm sure you're aware about this whole app that's come out since lockdown, and that's also made money. So I wonder if they got inspired from that, you know. But okay, so that's a good one, Kid and Play. I wonder whatever happened to them. I wonder if they're still, you know, doing things.
I'm not sure. I think I might look into it after this.
Right. No. Definitely. All right. Okay. So see that's yeah. Go ahead.
Half Baked.
Okay.
So. If you like David Chappelle,
yeah,
you should like this. This is his film from way back when.
I haven't seen this one. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, again, it's four friends. Yeah, him and three friends.
Yeah.
And their bond is really solidified through their love for smoking weed.
Yeah.
So. They're all in crappy little jobs, whatever, but all they live for is getting high as much as they can. One of them does something stupid,
yeah.
And gets arrested and put in prison. So they try and raise the bail money to get him out.
Yeah.
And they do it in a hilarious way by selling what they love. So then just going to different characters, you know, meeting up with like drug dealers and all of that stuff, and it's just crazy funny. It's crazy.
Okay,
if you like David Chappelle, you should love this.
No, I have enough respect for him, Dave Chappelle. And speaking about movie comedies, you know which one? And I don't know if you've seen it. And I love him as a comedian, Eddie Griffin, Undercover Brother.
Yeah, oh my god. Eddie Griffin's just funny. Just he doesn't even have to say anything. And you just look at him and you just laugh. Just got those expressions.
So Undercover Brother for me, Eddie Griffin, honestly, top movie. And that's what I'm saying. I love that movie, mate. What do you reckon?
That's a classic one, bro. I completely forgot about Undercover Brother. I completely forgot about Eddie Griffin. He's a short little man, funny face. Doesn't even have to say anything and he makes you laugh. But that film, his afro, that's what I'm trying to get. That's what I'm aiming for during this lockdown. I'm trying to get that Eddie Griffin Undercover Brother afro. It just makes me laugh
in that. Oh, honestly,
mate,
no.
I'm now gonna have to write that one down. Put that one.
I'm happy. I'm able to at least contribute because honestly, you gave me some great ones, and especially it's funny because we're kept within the context of Black Lives, but we've gone from, you know, grim and depressing, and then we've all made some good funny ones. Yeah.
It's. And I'm one of those people who likes to watch films I've seen again before, and I've seen Undercover Brother, and I think I've seen it a couple of times.
Yeah.
So
it's one of those films you don't really have to think much about. You're not going to get too invested in it emotionally. You're just going to sit there and just think, man, that's stupid, but it's funny. And it's one of those films that I'm now going to have to definitely put on my list to watch again. So my last comedy one.
Okay.
Before we go on to a cult classic that I'm sure probably a lot of people haven't heard about. But my last comedy one, and I'm not even sure a lot of people have heard of this one, is called CB4. From Dave Chappelle, I'm going to Chris Rock. So CB4. Right, stands for Cell Block 4, right? And it's a group of friends, three friends, who like, you know what, we can make money out of this. Why can't we be rappers and all of this stuff? Let's make some cash.
Yeah.
So they come up with this name and these personas. They're gangsters. They got the Jericho, but they're just some, some suburban kids, But it's just funny. It's just funny how they start talking about gangs. They start talking about girls, and they've got one of the NWA tracks as well in there that they've kind of taken on themselves. Straight out of Low Cash. It's just funny to watch, and I beg everybody to watch that. If you haven't heard of CB4 or Half Baked or House Party, I beg you go find those films and watch them during these difficult, crazy times, and just have a good laugh.
Abdi, honestly, you've covered some classic, and to make it all nice and educational, any people out there who has a teacher or who's a teacher, I recommend you guys, when you're having those half term coming up, holidays, make these kids watch these movies so they can at least learn some culture.
Exactly. To be honest, a lot of these kids are probably doing that anyway. Like they're studying online. Come on now, that's not happening. They're studying Netflix. That's what they're doing. And my last film during this mammoth of a redemption show from the first is a film from 1979. It's called Warriors. So I think a lot of people haven't heard about this. It's not a comedy, it's really about gang life in New York. So you've got all these different gangs. It is funny. I don't think it's meant to be funny, but it is funny. So you got all these gangs in New York, and then there's this elite gang, this top gang, who bring all these small gangs together. And the idea is that they all have a truce and work together and take over New York, right? There's more of them than the NYPD. So let's work together. But something goes wrong, and one of the and the leader who's giving this fantastic speech, "Can you dig it?" It's brilliant. Brilliant speech that he's given, gets shot, and then this particular gang's warriors get blamed for it. So they what they're trying to do is get back to their ends. They're trying to get back, and then they have to go through all these territories, and then you just get these silly gangs. One's wearing baseball uniforms, and that's what they are. And it's an insane one. I think they were skater ones. Brilliant watch. And in fact, do you remember Craig Mack, Flavor in Your Ear?
Yeah.
And the remix, and Puff Daddy did his bit. Well, he always does Bad Boys. But he does that bit where he starts hitting the two bottles together. And that's from the film, where he in the film it's like Warriors. They're clinking the bottles to come out to play, and he uses that in that track where it's like Bad Boys come out to play, and then the remix happens with LL Cool J, Notorious B.I.G., Craig Mack, Busta Rhymes. Great.
But hold up, Warrior, it started to fall back and come back to me. Was this the one where this is one black lady on a microphone giving a kind of a commentary? Oh my gosh, yeah. That's a classic movie, Abdi.
That's the one.
It's because for me, I watch a movie once and I don't watch it again. But that's why I always come to you when it comes to recommendation. You analyze these movies. Wow, that's a classic movie. That's a good choice.
It's a brilliant film. It's a brilliant film. And it, like I said, it doesn't try to be funny. I don't think it was attempting to be funny, but it just is with the different types of gangs, you know.
Nice.
They're my picks. Tell me what you think. And if any of your listeners, watch any of these, it's worthwhile. They leave a comment. Oh, to let me know if they think I'm just chatting gas and should shut up.
Nah, mate. I'll tell you right now for sure is that, like I said, and you and MJ are the people I come to when it comes to movies and TV shows. You specifically, because you actually will watch anything. It doesn't have to be Netflix. It could be from cinema. You make the effort. I bet if there was a movie club, you actually probably be the leader for your local movie club here, you know?
My friend, I've watched Love Actually. Notting Hill, just to give it a go, see if I like it. I mean, I didn't, but that's not the point. I like you said, I'll try and watch everything as much as I can.
One thing before we conclude, would you ever give foreign movies a go? I know some people don't like it because they hate reading the subtitles. Yeah, would you give foreign movies a go?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I love those kung fu films. Now, Shaolin Soccer, as I've mentioned,
yeah.
You can get it dubbed in English, but it's rubbish. Don't do that. Just watch it. Just watch it in its original language.
Mm.
And that's what I suggest. I suggest people always watch it in the original language. Sometimes the subtitles can get a little bit annoying, especially when they're speaking so fast, and you're like, I just want to watch the action. Especially if it's an action film as well. I just want to watch the action. Why am I reading this? No, rubbish.
What about? Have you ever tried? Two genres. I know because of you, I've watched a French movie. And what about Indian or Arabic movies? Have you ever given them a go?
See the Indian ones, right?
Yeah.
And this is me maybe stereotyping, right? I used to watch them when I was younger.
Yeah. For real?
It was watched in our house, and the Arabic ones. My mum always used to watch them.
Yeah.
But it didn't come with subtitles, so I'm just sitting there annoying her, saying, "What just happened?" And she's just pausing again. This is what happened. Look, don't you have anything else to do? Don't you want to go out with your friends? And mums don't really say this. You know that. African mums don't say that. Telling you to go out with your friends at night. You know, she wanted to watch her stuff in peace. But I always thought the Bollywood ones is like a musical. And I can't do musicals. I try to, but once people start breaking into dance. I can do the singing. I can handle the singing. But once they start breaking into dance, I'm kind of like, nah, bruv. So every time I think about an Indian film, I'm like, someone's going to dance somewhere. Right? All of a sudden, you're going to get like a flash mob out of nowhere. There is this one that I heard about. It's an Egyptian one, apparently.
Oh yeah,
and it's like a set in the not too distant future, but it's one where Israel doesn't exist.
No way.
So I wanted to find out a little bit more about that one.
No, Egypt is unique.
Where I can watch it. It's taken a lot of backlash.
Well, no. Egypt has a very unique relationship with Israel. It's kind of a love hate. One minute they're best friends, other minute they can't stand each other. So yes, I'm not surprised. There's a very, very interesting dynamics between those two countries, and soon come to light in the near future. But no, and okay, fair enough. In regards to your movies, I have to admit, at first when you started off, I was honestly down, and I'm like, come on, man, we live in a world already, we're surrounded by news. But they were all important movie recommendations, TV. I mean, at the end of the day, especially if you, if you're gonna have a cause, don't be a rebel without a cause. At least understand where people are coming from. But I also love your other movies afterwards, because it does cheer you up. You know, the good old days when you actually, you know, when there was not
the, the Coming to America's, and
classic.
Sit back and relax and just laugh.
Man, no, I love it, and for me, I will put them to my list. But yeah, like Abdi said, guys, and please, and shout us out if you think that the choice Abdi made were good or not. If you actually, you know, are gonna watch them, it would be good to get some feedback on that. Now, Abdi, anything else you want to give a shout out before we conclude this session?
No, not much, man. I mean, just everyone keep on doing what they're doing, I guess. Definitely make the most of this difficult situation. And spend time with the family. I mean, I've got to spend a lot of time with my kids, although, to be honest, I've been probably on Netflix more than spending time with them. So that's
I do
encourage, make the most of this. We're not going to get situations like this again. Hopefully not.
Yeah. And like we said in the beginning, these are movies to watch in the second wave, and I don't think the UK
before I'm saying in the second wave or before the second wave. I'm one of those people, you know. I'm thinking the second wave is not coming for a while. It's coming. It's not coming for a while. So we've got plenty of time to watch these movies. In fact, you should be able to watch every single one of them before the second wave hits.
Others
might think you've probably only got one or two to watch. So make your choices wisely.
Well, the funny thing, once someone said beautifully on Twitter, they said, what's the concern about second wave? The way we're losing our lockdown restrictions, we're never even going to finish the first wave, you know? But anyway, that's a different topic. I don't want to...
That is a different topic. It's probably a topic that we should avoid, I think. Let's keep it nat.
Big time, nah, honestly, 100%. All right, okay, so, and honestly, Abdi, once again, it's been a pleasure. Thank you for joining me today. And actually, I'm going to give a shout out to everyone to make sure you listen to this list and also give us some feedback. Okay, guys, until the next time, peace and love. Well, that's all, folks. Thank you for listening to my podcast, which is simply the reflections of a nomad consultant living life on a day-by-day basis. I just want to conclude by saying, I appreciate the love and support you guys are showing me. Until the next time, peace and love.